Coming on the clouds with fire, the whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes, yeah. I see his love and mercy washing over all our sins, the people. The people sing.
Sing it out, church.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. I see a new revival stirring as we pray and sing. We're on our knees, we're on our knees. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna.
Understanding, but Lord, we lean on you, God, in your Holy Spirit. I'm going to introduce the next song we're going to sing because it's a new one, and I think it's funny that I'm a new face singing a new song here, but it's called New Wine, and there's something so beautiful about what comes out of the surrender in our lives to the Lord, and it's the result of that is new wine. God, we thank you for the crushing and the pressing and the things that we've walked through. God, the things that you have literally held us through, God, and how we've clung to you. Lord, we thank you that you are always making something new out of us. God, always making something new out of us when things are hard, when we don't understand. Lord, it is just an opportunity to lean on you, to cling to you, God, and to trust you more. So, Lord, let our hearts be that of surrender. Lord, surrender to you. Lord, that we would be your vessels, we would be an offering. God, whatever you want us to be, Lord, we will be that. We want to follow you, Jesus. In the crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. In the sore I now surrender, for you are breaking new ground. So I yield to you and to your careful hand. When I trust you, I don't need to understand. So make me a vessel. Oh, make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. Oh, Lord, I came here with nothing, but all you have given me. Oh, Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Sing this out in the crushing. In the crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. In the sore I now surrender, for you are breaking new ground. You are breaking new ground. So make me a vessel and make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. Oh Lord, I came. But all you have given me, oh Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Oh Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Oh Jesus, bring new wine out of me. 'Cause where there is new wine, there is new power. There is new freedom, and the kingdom is here. I lay down my old flames to carry your new fire today. We surrender, 'cause where there is new wine, there is new power. There is new I lay down my old flames to carry your new fire today. So make me a vessel and make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. And Lord, I came here with nothing, but all you have given me, oh Jesus, make new wine out of me. Oh Jesus,
Everything that is, Lord. You know everything about every part of us and every part of our world. And yes, we trust you. We put our lives in your hands because we know you love us so much that you gave your very best. You gave your all that we would have life, eternal life, and life abundantly here. Jesus, not an easy life sometimes. Life that will glorify you. Thank you, Jesus. A reminder of the story of Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. They would not bow down to the false gods. They would not bow down to the world. And they went through the fire. I remind us today, they went through the fire. They did not escape the fire. Except the Lord Jesus was right there with them in the fire. He was there with them in the fire. So they went through a struggle. They went through a lot of fear, a lot of concern about their life. And we go through those things so often when we hear something from the doctor. Or different thoughts come to us. But if you look in the book of Peter, it says in verse 7, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 7, that the trial of your faith, the trial of your faith, we have faith in Jesus Christ. Say, why do I need to have a trial? Jesus had a trial. Paul had a trial. All the disciples, pretty much, even John, had a trial, right? Christians have trials. Unbelievers have trials too, but guess what? We have Jesus. Isn't that awesome? We have Jesus. That the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perishes, though it be tried with fire, might be found. Said might. If we hold on, he that endures to the end, the same would be saved. Yes? Might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. Woo! So know that your God is faithful. He is faithful and he loves us. And he's so good to us. So good to us. Wow. Well, welcome everyone. Very good morning. We're blessed of the Lord. Coming into the house of God with the people of God. No better place to be, right? That's what David said. He wanted to go to the house of God. He said he'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord than to dwell in tents of wickedness. Be a doorkeeper, man. Let's just serve, right? Just be in God's presence. Be with his people. So, Father, we thank you for the children that you've given to the families here. Thank you for what you're doing in each life, each family. And we ask that your spirit would be there in the homes of these families to minister and set the example to the children. Bless the children in their classrooms today and help them to know the value of the relationship that they have with you. And the teachers, a special anointing on them. And Lord, for what you provide for us, our words can't say thanks enough. We have people we know all over the world that are just starving. And they don't have clothing. They don't have a good roof on their head. And we have so much. God, help us to be thankful and to show that gratitude by the way we live and the way we give. We're grateful for you, Lord Jesus, for all you do for us. And we ask for a blessing on the message. The word of God today is blessed. It's anointed. But anoint the man of God, Pastor Vic, to come and share the word of God with us and continue to touch each heart and life here. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Brother, come on. Y'all give this brother a hand.
Well, good morning. It is good to be back with you guys today, and we're glad to see all of you. If you're streaming online or catching this after the fact, we're glad that you have joined us. And that's just my prayer that God is going to speak to you this morning and that God's going to touch you. You know, during worship, I just want to call something out really quickly before I start. During worship, towards the end of worship, I felt like there's somebody here who is having an issue with your right leg and a pain going down the back of your right leg. If that is you this morning, please come see me after the service is over because I want to pray for you. I believe God shows us these things because he intends to do something about them. And so it's just a very specific thing. And so if that's you at the end of the service, you come see me and we will pray for you. You know, this morning I want to take the opportunity to encourage you in your faith with a message that I've entitled, Keep Your Eyes on the Lord. A little over a week ago, our nation went to the polls to elect the next president of the United States. And what's followed since November 3rd is uncertainty and unrest as final votes in key states are still being contested today. All you have to do is just turn on the news or go online and you understand the chaos that is happening all around us as we look at coming out of this election day and the fact that it's still not decided and there's so much division there. As we wait for the results to come in, The news of electoral fraud is multiplying despite the attempts of the media to, I believe, censor the truth and the facts. You know, you you get out to these news outlets and you can't even believe what you're hearing, that it's the truth, because there seems to be a concerted effort to obscure the truth or to hide the truth. There are states where the number of votes is actually greater than the number of voters in the state. There are questions about the validity of mail-in votes and the accuracy of the voting machines themselves. We find social media, the social media giants are by very large margin censoring conservative posts while allowing false statements to go forward, and they're adding to the division that we see on a massive scale in the country right now. We find influential people speaking out and continuing to make statements that are dividing the nation. And as Christians, we find ourselves this morning standing back and waiting to see what is really going to happen. And I believe that all of this, and maybe you're dealing with other things in your life that aren't even related to what's going on in the country around us, but maybe you're facing difficulty in your own life. Maybe it's a medical diagnosis, or maybe it is a procedure that you're facing, or maybe it's an issue in a relationship, or maybe it is something that has been on your heart relative to your children or somebody that you love, or maybe it's a work-related issue this morning. I know that we are all faced with issues every single day. And I know that all of these, and especially this election cycle and what's going to happen in the end, brings a certain amount of anxiety and unrest and even fear, particularly in the church today, as many in the nation wonder what tomorrow is really going to bring. What will the changes be over the next 4 years? What's going to happen with the job market and the economy? What is the response going to be to the pandemic as a new administration potentially takes over and we see that COVID is supposedly on the rise again? Where's the next administration, whoever it might be, going to stand on the issues? Where will the nation spiral into ungodliness, or will we continue down the path that we've seen over the recent years of at least embracing godliness as a nation, trying to get back to our core values? Will Christians and the church see increased persecution? Some may even be asking the question, could this be the beginning of the end? Are we really in those end times that we read about in Scripture? The answer to that is yes, we are in the end times. If you haven't noticed, we're getting closer and closer to the return of Jesus. If Jesus' disciples 2,000 years ago believed and taught that it could be any moment and that we are there, and 2,000 years ago that Jesus is literally at the doorstep, how much more do we see that today? But the truth of the matter is, if you pay attention to everything that you see around you and all of this bombardment that we have, it can be overwhelming at times. And the question really becomes, what should we do as Christians? What should our stance be as Christians? How should we face life every single day in light of the uncertainty that we see around us? As I think about all these things personally, I'm reminded of something that Paul said to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 1. It's a simple verse that everybody knows here, or should know here. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but he's given us a spirit of power and love and of a sound mind. You see, when you read that scripture, you'll see that Paul commends Timothy for his faith, and he tells Timothy right before he says this, Timothy, I'm commending you for your faith. I'm telling you to stir up the gift that God has put within you. In other words, be about God's business. Focus on ministry. Focus on the calling that God has for your life. And then he says to Timothy, God has not given you a spirit of fear. In other words, walk in boldness. Walk in the power and the anointing of the Lord, because the spirit that you have been given, which is the Holy Spirit, is a spirit of power and of love and a sound mind. That's the spirit that we have been given. And he says to walk in that. And so, in other words, God has given you his spirit, and his spirit isn't a spirit of fear. And so we know right away that if we have fear or anxiety in us this morning, that it's not coming from the Lord. God is not the author of that. God is not giving you that fear, because his spirit gives us the exact opposite. His spirit gives us a boldness and a confidence, not in ourselves, but in who he is, that in spite of what we see, in spite of what may transpire around us, that we know as we look to him that it's going to be okay. And so if we're struggling with anxiety, if we're struggling with fear, when we look at the unknown, we know it's either coming from one or two places. It's either coming from the enemy, and there is a spirit of fear. I believe there is a spiritual force. It is a spirit of fear that operates in this world. And sometimes it is a spirit of fear that comes against us. And when we find that that is the case and we discern that that is the case, we simply need to tell the enemy to shut up and go away. We need to tell the enemy to back off. We need to understand our authority. And my son preached a message on Wednesday night at our church in Covington, and he preached a great message about understanding our authority and understanding the authority that the enemy doesn't have. We forget sometimes the authority that God has given us, and we give the enemy too much authority. And he brought out a simple illustration, and he talked about his children, and he said this. He said, how many of you have faced a time in your life where your children tried to take more authority than they were rightfully able to take? Maybe they got in your face and they began to tell you what it was going to be. Maybe they were going to tell you what they felt. Maybe they were going to tell you how things were going to unfold. And in that moment, as all good parents do, we simply look at them and we say, you better get in your place. You better back off. Do you understand who you are talking to? I'm your father. I'm your mother. You don't have that right. You don't have that authority. You know, the enemy tries to take that authority that is not due to him every single day. He will get in our face. He will get in our business, and he will begin to try to operate in an authority that is no longer his. The Bible tells me that when I gave my life to Jesus Christ, that I was forgiven of my sin, that I was delivered from darkness, I was delivered from the power of the enemy. You know, the Bible tells us that when Jesus died on the cross, that he made a spectacle of the enemy, that the enemy's authority had been stripped away. All that authority that the enemy once had, he no longer has over you and I. And so when the enemy comes in and he tries to tell us a lie, when the enemy comes in and he tries to stir up fear or anxiety in us, we simply need to look to the Lord, and we simply need to look at the enemy and say, I'm not buying into it today, because you don't have that authority. That authority has been taken from you by Jesus Christ, and I'm a child of the Lord, and I choose to believe what God tells me. I choose to walk in his authority. And sometimes we have to make that stand. Sometimes we have to stand our ground, and we simply have to face that giant, and we simply have to say, no more. I choose to believe the truth of God's word. And then there's a second source of fear and anxiety, and that's our flesh. Sometimes it has nothing to do with the enemy, but it has everything to do with us. In those times, we allow our anxiety, we allow our concerns and our doubts to well up within us and to begin to take over. And in those times, we need to look to God, and we need to get into his presence and get the peace that he gives us in the midst of the storm. You see, the answer to fear in my flesh, the answer to uncertainty in my flesh, the answer to the struggle that I have within myself is always to get into his presence and to allow him to renew and change my thinking and my mind, to allow him to minister to me. In 1 Samuel chapter 30, we find David and his men had been off fighting a battle. And the Bible tells us that when they were done with this battle on the third day, that they came back to their hometown to find that an enemy had come in and destroyed the city, burned it with fire, and carried off all of their families. Their wives and their children had been taken away, and their city was in ruin. And in verse 3, the Bible tells us this: so David and his men came to the city, and there it was, burned with fire, and their wives, their sons, and their daughters had been taken captive. And then David and the people who were with him lifted up their voices, and they wept until they had no more power to weep. David's two wives, Ahinoam and the Jezreelitess, and Abigail, the widow of Nabal, the Carmelite, had been taken captive. Now David was distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and daughters. Maybe you find yourself in that place today. Maybe you find yourself in the place where the attack of the enemy has been so strong that you look at your life and you say, my life seems to me to be in ruins. It seems to me that there is no way out. It seems to me that everything that is precious to me, everything that I value, has been stripped away by the enemy and carried off by the enemy. And it's an overwhelming thing to you. Maybe all of those people who you thought were your friends, those people who would normally come alongside of you and encourage you, are no longer encouraging you. David found himself in that place. He had gone out and he had won a battle, but in coming back, he had found that he had lost everything that he held dearly and everything that he loved. And not only that, his own men who would go and fight with him were talking about taking his life and stoning him. So what did David do? David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. You see, that's a word to us this morning. Did you catch that? Sometimes when we find those situations where it doesn't seem like things could get any worse, it seems like all of life is against us and all of hell is against us and life is closing in and pressing in on us. In those moments, we need to encourage ourselves in the Lord. David encouraged himself in the Lord. He strengthened himself in the Lord. When no one around him was going to strengthen him, when no one around him was going to speak words of life to him, based off of his relationship with the Lord, who he knew God to be, he strengthened himself in the Lord. In that moment of fear and crisis, then God spoke to David and gave him strength and direction to go forward. You see, when David surrendered to the Lord, when David gave it over to the Lord, and David said, you know what, I may see what I see, and it looks disastrous, but God is bigger than this situation, and I'm going to strengthen myself in the Lord. You see, the same God who delivered me from the bear and the lion, the same God who delivered me from Goliath, the same God who has been with me in battle is going to continue to go with me in battle. When David did that and put himself in that place and got before the Lord, God began to speak to him. And they went and they were able to recover 100% of everything that they lost. They were able to go and rescue their families. They were able to go and plunder the enemy. And so they came back with more wealth than they left with. That's the God that we serve this morning. Church, we need to get to the place where we're encouraging ourselves and one another in the Lord in spite of what we see around us. The place where we stop believing what the enemy is telling us, the place where we look beyond what we see in the natural, and we begin to trust God for peace and strength to make it through. Now, how do I find that peace and strength to make it through? I don't pay any attention to what the news is telling me. I trust God in spite of what the news is telling me. You see, it's my prayer that God's plan and his purpose is going to unfold for this nation and unfold for this world exactly as he intends it to unfold. It's my prayer that evil will be exposed. It is my prayer that the truth will come forward. It is my prayer that God's person will wind up in the White House one way or another. And I trust that no matter who's in the White House, God is still on his throne. I trust that no matter what happens tomorrow, that I can still trust in the Lord. You see, I don't look to kings and rulers as my source of comfort. I don't look to administrations. I don't look to lawgivers as my peace and my comfort this morning. I look to the God who gives me peace and comfort in the midst of the storm, when things work out and when things don't. You see, that's the God that we serve, and that's where real peace comes in. That kind of peace only comes from knowing God and spending time with God. I think about David, who over and over in the Psalms talked about his relationship with the Lord. He talked about the fact that God was his refuge and his strength, an ever-present help in the time of trouble. He talked about the fact that God was the one who heard his cries, that God was the one who answered his prayers. It's all over the Psalms when you read the heart of David. He knew this because he spent time in God's presence. God changed him, and that's what we need to see in our life. I can think of no better example this morning than Jehoshaphat in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And I want to spend a little bit of time there this morning. In 2 Chronicles chapter 20, this is what we read, and it happened after this that the people of Moab with the people of Ammon and others with them besides the Ammonites came to battle against Jehoshaphat. And some came and told Jehoshaphat, saying, a great multitude is coming against you from beyond the sea, from Syria, and they are in Hazon Tamar, which is in En-Gedi. And Jehoshaphat feared, and he set himself to seek the Lord and proclaimed a fast throughout all of Judah. You see, this was a time in the life of Jehoshaphat where he was going through some struggles with nations around him. And in the midst of all of this happening, all of a sudden one of his advisors come to him and they say, we're in trouble. There are many nations who are forming battle lines against us and they are coming to invade the country. The Bible tells us that Jehoshaphat then was afraid. You see, but Pastor Vic, we're not supposed to be afraid. You know, in the natural, fear is a natural thing. It happens. It's not the fact that you're afraid or you're not afraid. It's what you do with that fear. It's where you go when you have those times of fear, right? I believe that, you know, it's a natural thing that we would be fearful, even though it is not from the Lord, even though we should not allow our flesh to rise up. It happens, and the question is, what do we do when we get in that place? Jehoshaphat did the right thing. He sought the Lord, and he fasted. But when I look at this passage, and I just even begin to read it, it jumps out at me, and it speaks to me this morning, because it starts out with three or four words, and it says this: it happened after this. It happened after this. You see, so many times when we're reading Scripture, we pass through phrases like that, and we try to get to something that we think is a little more meaty. But you know what? That phrase, and it happened after this, speaks a lot to us, because it tells me that life happens. It tells me that in my lifetime, there are going to be things that are going to come up that are unplanned things. Jehoshaphat was not expecting that enemy nations were going to come against him. He was not expecting at this point that he was going to see this time in his life of great distress, but it just happened in his life that it just showed up. And the question is then, what does he do with that in his life? It reminds me that in the life of every Christian, things are going to happen. We're going to face tests and trials. They're going to be a part of life, and as much as we would like to hope otherwise, we're not exempt from the storms of life. You see, we would like to think that as Christians, we're exempt from the storms of life, that these things simply won't touch us. And, you know, that's true to a point. It is true that we are God's children and we are blessed by Him. And as God's children, I can expect His blessing. I can expect His protection. I can expect His covering. But as Christians, we're still living in a nation that is a divided nation. And things that happen in this nation are going to affect us. As Christians, we are still working at jobs that are what they are. And when we go there, we're going to be affected by what is going on there. We're going to face times of struggle, times of testing, times of trials in our life. And the question is then, what do we do with those times of trials and those times of testing? In James chapter 1, James tells us this: my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. And we look at James and we say, what? Have you lost your mind? Count it all joy when you face trials of many kinds? How many of you here count it joy when things go wrong in your life? That's your first response. That's your first reaction, to jump up and down and start clapping and say, I am so glad that this happened in my life. But yet James says, count it all joy when these things happen in your life. Why? Because God is up to something. Because in the midst of the trials and the tests that we go through, God is working in our life. And this very scripture tells us that He's working patience in our life. He's taking us from where we're at and He's fine-tuning us. He is changing us to the picture of what He wants us to be so that we're able to minister and to be a better picture of His Son, Jesus Christ. Let patience have its perfect work, so that you can be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. You're going through trials. You're going through tests. You look at things happening around you, and it's concerning you. God is perfecting you in the process if you will let Him perfect you. And so what do? We should embrace those trials. We should embrace those tests. How many of you know some of those tests and trials are orchestrated by God? They are planned by God. It's not just a random thing that happens. You know, so I'm going through the test. I'm going through the trial. These things are happening in my life. God sends us to school. He sends us to spiritual school. And in God's school system, we don't go to the next grade until we're ready to go to the next grade, right? You know, in our public school system, we eventually just pass people on, right? Eventually, you age out. Eventually, we just can't keep you in third grade anymore because you got to move on. you're becoming a teenager, you can't be in third grade anymore. In God's kingdom, he's going to continue to work with us until we get it. So that means that those trials and those tests that we go through, if we don't embrace those things, if we don't learn what he's trying to teach us in the process, if we don't look to him, he's just going to continue to allow those things to come into our life until he turns us to what we need to be, until those issues in our lives are taken care of. And so I've written down here, and this is something that I believe, this morning it's not a question of if the storms will come, it's a question of what you do when they come. You see, what defines us as a Christian isn't whether or not we're exempt from the storms of life. We're not exempt from the storms of life. What defines us as a Christian is what we do and how we respond to the storms of life. You see, when people look at us and they see the example of how we're going through the test and the trial, how we're facing the uncertainty that we see in our nation, what are we doing as we watch the news and we see all of the division that's happening? Are we being the church? Are we calling for unity? Are we pointing people to Jesus Christ? Or are we saying, no, God has got this under control, really believing that God has got this under control? Are we being ambassadors for Jesus in the midst of it? At the end of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus gives us the key to weathering storms. He goes through several chapters of teaching, and it's great teaching, and he comes down to this conclusion. He says, therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, everybody says does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain descended, the floods came, the winds blew and beat on the house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. What is that rock? That rock is Jesus Christ. It's his teaching. It's the precepts of God's word. He said, but everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. The rains descended, the floods came, the winds blew, beat on that house, and it fell, and great was its fall. You see, both of these men built their house. Both of these men were doing life. They thought they had it together. They thought they had it figured out. I want you to understand that both of them faced the storms of life, right? It wasn't just the foolish man who faced the storms of life. It was the wise man who faced the storms of life. Again, we're not exempt from the storms of life. But it was the man who built his foundation on biblical principles, on the teaching of Jesus Christ as Jesus is Lord and Savior, and surrendered to him. It was him who was able to weather the storm when the other man came to ruin. And so what's the message as relates to storms in life and tests and trials? Run to him, not away from him. Embrace what he's doing in your life, and in the midst of the trials and the storms, don't fix your eyes on the storm, fix your eyes on Jesus Christ. Look to him and say, Lord, I choose to look at you in the midst of what may be a scary situation. 2 Chronicles 20, verse 3, Jehoshaphat feared. He set himself to seek the Lord. He proclaimed a fast, and so Judah gathered to ask help from the Lord, and all the cities of Judah, they came to seek the Lord. And so Jehoshaphat got serious. He said, this enemy, this thing that we face is very serious. It's time to go to prayer. It's time to seek the Lord. How many of you know that as Christians this morning, we should be seeking the Lord like we have never sought the Lord, especially in light of the times that we're finding ourselves in? We should be lifting up this election and the results to the throne room of heaven. We should be asking God to intervene. We should be asking God that his will would be fulfilled, whatever his will would be in this election, that it would be fulfilled. We should be praying for the church. We should be praying for the opportunity to be out there, to be ministering. We should pray for the lost. We should pray that God would use us and this church in this time. And Jehoshaphat called prayer. And he said, let's fast, let's pray, let's trust the Lord. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5, trust the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, in all your ways acknowledge him. He will direct your paths. That word came out this morning. It's a powerful word. Trust in the Lord. There's a message there that I could preach about who we should trust in. Trust in the Lord. Not my government, not my finances, not my job, not my ability to figure it out, not my own charisma, not my own natural talents, but trust in the Lord. All of those things are good. All of those things are helpful and useful in life. But God has said, trust me. Lean not on your understanding, but look for my understanding, my wisdom. And if you acknowledge me, I'll see you through. I'll give you the wisdom that you need to get through. I'll give you everything that you need to be able to make it to tomorrow and through tomorrow. And then Jehoshaphat prayed a great prayer. If you read in this passage, he prayed a great prayer, reminding himself and the people of who God is and what God had done for his people. You see, he recalled God's greatness. He recalled God's goodness. And then Jehoshaphat stood in the assembly of Jerusalem in the house of the Lord before the new court. And he said, O Lord, God of our fathers, are you not God in heaven? Do you not rule over the kingdoms of the nations? And in your hand is there not power and might so that no one is able to withstand you? Are you not our God who drove out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and gave it to the descendants of Abraham, your friend, forever? You see, he began to pray and remind the people. He began to pray to God and to remind God and to remind himself just who God is, that he is on our side. He goes with us. He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. If he is for us, who can be against us? He and he alone is the one who can deliver us from the fiery furnace, from the mouth of the lion. He is the only one who is going to save us from the enemy. As we look to him, he's going to give us the strength and the ability and the wisdom to be able to weather the storm. And Jehoshaphat just began to recount those things that God had done. You guys have a testimony, in spite of everything that you've been through, in spite of everything that you've seen personally and as a church, in spite of what you face even in this world today, we all have a testimony. We know that God has been faithful through it all. We understand that in our darkest hours, our darkest times, that he has come through before. And I believe he's going to do it again. I believe as we trust him that he is not going to fail us. He will never fail us. I believe he's going to be faithful to his word if we will be faithful to his word and be faithful to him. Just like David did, by the way. You read in Psalms all the time in the Old Testament writings in 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Chronicles, where you read about the accounts of David, how David constantly reminded himself about the goodness of God and who God was. There were times when David said, "Be still, my soul within me." That fear, he said, "Calm down. God is in control." And he began to remind himself about how God delivered him in very serious things. And then he reminds God, this is interesting, that Israel is God's people. He begins to pray this and he says, look, he said, aren't you the one who drove out the inhabitants of the land before Israel and gave it to the descendants of Abraham, your friend, forever, and they, your people, dwell in it and have built a sanctuary for you in your name, saying, if disaster comes, sword or judgment, pestilence, famine, we're going to still stand in this temple before your presence and cry out to you in our affliction, and you will hear and save? You see, he began to say, Lord, I'm going to remind you, I'm your child. We're your chosen people. You are special this morning. You see, we're not out there just facing this on our own in our own strength. When I walked down the aisle and I surrendered my life to Jesus Christ, something happened. There was a transformation that happened in my life. Not only did I go from spiritual death to spiritual life, but I was adopted into the family of God. I'm bought with a price. There was a price that he paid. Jesus died and gave his own life so that I could have life, so that I could live. And I am precious in his sight. You are precious in his sight. We've been adopted into the family of God, and we have full rights as children of God. That should excite you this morning because you're not out there on your own. You're not doing life on your own. There's an expectancy that you can have that he walks with you through the fire. There's an expectancy that no matter what you face, that he's not going to walk away from you because you are his very child. And so he reminded him of that. And then I love this because he begins to plead his case and he comes down to this. And this is the point of the whole message this morning. He gets real with God and he says, for we have no power against this great multitude that is coming against us, nor do we know what to do but our eyes around you. You see, he comes to the point where he realizes that this army is coming against him, that the odds are not in their favor, that it looks like they're going to come to certain defeat if God doesn't intervene. And he says, Lord, here's the facts. We're powerless to change this situation. We don't even know what to do, but our eyes are on you. How many of you find yourself in that situation on a regular basis? where you feel completely powerless to change things around you. Now, we can look at that as Christians today and say, man, this thing is out of our control, right? These election results are going to happen no matter what. Things are going to happen in my life no matter what. You know, what control do I have? And sometimes we feel powerless, but you know what? We're not powerless, because as we stand in faith and we trust in Him, you see, we serve the one who controls it all. We serve the one who has all power, all authority, the one who works on our behalf. And so He says, Lord, we're powerless. We don't even know what to do, but our eyes are on You. Can I encourage you to keep your eyes fixed on Him? Can I encourage you to look past all of the distraction, everything that you see? Look past the diagnosis that the doctor is giving you. I'm not saying ignore it, but I'm saying look to the Lord. Look beyond it and to say, Lord, I see it, I understand it, but I know that You're able to change things. I know that You're able to heal. I know You're able to deliver. I know You're able to change the course of nations and political systems for Your honor and Your glory. See, that's exactly what Jehoshaphat did. And it's interesting, because what happened was then, if you read in that passage, and I'll close out, the prophet speaks up. Jehoshaphat prays this, and he says, Lord, we're powerless. We don't know what to do. Our eyes are on You. And then God speaks, and God says, I'm going to fight this battle for you. He says, you're going to go out to battle. They're going to meet you in battle, but guess what? You're not going to even have to fight the battle, because I'm going to fight the battle for you. How great is that? The victory is ours, but the battle is the Lord's. That's what Scripture tells us, right? It's the best deal ever. We receive the victory. He fights the battle for us. And so they line up. They're going out to battle. And what do? They send the worship team out first. Love it, right? So they're getting ready to go out to battle, and Jehoshaphat says, okay, all of you worshipers, let's get out in front. And they begin to praise the Lord. There is power in praising God in the middle of the storm. Think of Paul and Silas in the prison, in the midnight hour when they're in prison and they've been beaten and their bodies are hurting and there's no way that they think they're going to get out. And what do? They begin to praise God in the middle of the storm, and the prison is shaken. The doors are open. Their chains are loosed. That's the power of the God that we serve. And when the singers went out in front of the army and began to praise God, God showed up, and the enemy began to attack each other. The enemy took care of himself. The division within the enemy's camp took care of the enemy, and God got the victory. Jehoshaphat got the victory, not because of them, but because of who God is. You see, that's the God that we serve, the God who's able to take impossible situations and turn them around. You see, the world would want us to think, and Satan would want us to think, that all is lost. It's not something that can be recovered. The nation is never going to be the same. The church is never going to be the same. You're done. Your life is over. Just sign it away. It's done. But God is a God who changes circumstances and situations. He is a God who speaks to dry bones, and He says they're going to live again. You see, that word, that song that we sang this morning about new wine, that's a prophetic word for this church. You need to understand, that's a prophetic word for this church. And what God is saying to this church is, if you will surrender to Him, He's going to do incredible new things that you haven't even imagined are going to happen. And it comes as you surrender to Him. It comes as we surrender to Him. And it's exciting, because He can take us from the place where life is pressing in and it's crushing all around us, and He's able to turn that around and to bring something out of it, something new, something fresh. I'm excited about what God is going to do. I'm excited about what He's doing. When I look at all these things happening, I don't get depressed. I don't get discouraged. I don't get afraid anymore, because I'm looking beyond it, and I'm fixing my eyes on Jesus Christ, and I'm saying, Lord, You are still on the throne no matter what happens. You saw me through today. You're going to see me through tomorrow. And worst case scenario, if I give my life for You in this side of glory, I'm going to be in heaven forever. I'm going to be with You forever. And so, hey, how bad could it get, right? I'm going to be with Him for eternity. You're going to be with Him for eternity. Keep it into perspective. Why don't you stand with me? I want to pray for you this morning. I want to ask for God's blessing on you and on this church. Father, as we come before you this morning, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that you are the God of hope, Lord. You are the God who gives us a plan and a future, Lord. Father, I thank you that you are for us and not against us, Lord. And I thank you that even when the battle seems to rage around us, Lord, when the enemy seems to even be gaining ground, Lord, that as we look to you, we can trust, Lord, that you're going to see us through. Lord, I'm asking that you would help us to resolutely fix our eyes on you. Lord, help us to not look at the distractions around us, what the enemy is doing, the storms that are raging. But Lord, help us to keep our eyes on you and to trust you in the midst of the storm. Lord, I know that you're going to bring us through to the other side. Lord, I know that you have a plan and a purpose, Lord, and I know that the enemy is not going to frustrate your plans. Lord, I'm asking that you would frustrate the enemy's plans. Lord, I'm praying for this nation this morning. Lord, I'm praying that the truth would come out, Lord, and that lies would be exposed in the name of Jesus. Lord, I'm asking that your will would be accomplished, Lord, in and through this nation. Lord, I'm asking that the enemy's plans would come to nothing in the name of Jesus, Lord. And I speak success on your plans, your purposes. Have your way, Lord, in this country. Lord, have your way at Living Word Church. Lord, use us in this time, in this place, to build your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you guys this morning.